So I already talked about Suricata at the previous NetDev conference. We are started to work on implementing bypass for Suricata in the NF filter and NFQ context. And I just wanted to tell you the journey I had in the 6 months between Sevilla and Tokyo when working on implementing a bypass for Hive packet capture method. So as everybody was looking at Jamal for the TC workshop in Sevilla, let's get a few words about Suricata, and mainly just to discover what are our problem on in terms of performance, what are our constraints, and so you will understand why we are working on bypass on similar technology. So Suricata is an IDS/IPS engine. It has a lot of capture method, and it allow you to analyze the packet and then extract metadata protocol information from the packet and then do filtering on that. So what it's doing is that it's able to recognize the protocol and then to do an analysis of a protocol and then extract the metadata information. So it's mostly used in the IDS part, so intrusion detection system, which means that it will just get the packet from any capture method and then do a reconstruction of the flow. So we are not working on the host side, getting the packet with a usual kernel stack, but we have our own user space stack where we try to understand what is going on the network by just getting the packet. So that's one of our main constraints. And what we want to do is that we want to have an analysis which is accurate enough to be able to find some pattern in the reconstructed flow that will allow us to know that there is currently an attack going on the server or the assets that we want to protect. So we have an understanding. Oops, sorry, this is not. Which one is. Okay. So we have an understanding of a protocol. For example, HTTP, SMTP, a lot more are coming. We've got different capture methods like NDES, Napatech, CUDA, or PF Ring on Hive Packet too. And just to give you an example of what we are doing. So let's say we have a Suricata running at NetDev, and we want to intercept and have an alert every time somebody is chatting on Facebook and talking about NetDev in the message. So I need to. So if I manage to get the laser pointer. Why? That's cool. Okay, so what we are doing is that we want to check that we got a post on this page. So we got our language, we're saying that we have a content post in the HTTP method. That the HTTP host is Facebook, so then the HTTP URI is slash AJAX slash send slash send.php. So we are checking all that by getting TCP packet, reconstructing the stream, then analyzing HTTP protocol to extract the different information and give access to them in the rule language. It's even worse because if we look at this one, we look to NetDev in the HTTP client body, which means that we are currently analyzing the content of the HTTP body message. And in some case, maybe more in the HTTP server body, it can be compressed. So we decompressed on the fly the content, then we do pattern matching inside of the content. So just to say, but it's really, really performance intensive. And we have no pass-through. We are not a firewall. So for instance, the basic rule set is around 15,000 signatures. So we've got 50,000 checks to do on this reconstructed stream, so which is really, really expensive. So that's why we have got some optimization to be able to well, do some pre-filtering, and this pre-filtering allow us to skip a lot of signature and then just focus on the one that, that should really match on the content. So the main technique that we are using for that is the multi-pattern matching using algorithms just as AOCoRASIC and things like that. So it's just a hash top on the running Suricata, so we can see that we are really multi-thread. Everybody is working and we are using a lot of the CPU, so this is something like 16 CPU running, so that should be something that we can handle, something like a 4 or 5 gigabyte link, or maybe a little bit more. If we look at perftop, what we see is that the research function is taking almost all the CPU time, so we are really, really CPU intensive. And so what we need to optimize a lot in Suricata is this part, and optimization can be done or by strict algorithm optimization, or simply by trying to inspect less things. On scalability side, we run from 150 to 500 megabytes per second per thread or per core. And we can use scaling using RSSQ or cluster flow balancing, things like that. One of the major capture methods in Suricata is IF packet. We'll skip that because you almost know that. And one of the recent new features is the load balancing, which allows us to split the load of one interface over multiple sockets, and then in front of a multiple socket, we put different Suricata threads, so we manage to scale the load for something which is superior to 1 gigabyte or something like that. So the typical architecture will look like that. We've got the one Ethernet card, and then we will do a load balancing on using RSSQ, so we got all the queue. We pin the CPU, and then below the CPU, we put one thread that will do all the analysis, so capturing the packet, decoding, reconstructing the stream, then running the detection engine, and at the end, output information if we have input information to display. This is the ideal world, because we've got some little problem, and one of the problems we have is that we really need the flow hash to be symmetric. Because if the flow hash is not symmetric, we will have some real issue. By symmetric, I mean that when I compute the hash that will tell in which RSSQ or in which thread will do the treatment of all the packet for a flow, I want all the packet for a single flow to be sent to the same thread. If I don't do that, I will have this kind of thing. For example, I got one thread which is handling all the traffic, a part of the traffic, so I've got a few packets, a packet from client, and then on another thread, I got the other part of the flow, which is there. So when I dequeue the packet one by one, I will get this content at the end, to client, and then from client. So if it's the opening, for example, of a session, we will have the scene hack that will be the scene that will be the last packet, and then we get scene hack on hack. So we got everything which is reversed. So as we want to reconstruct everything on the client on the Suricata side to be able to understand what is really going on the network, we just failed in that case. And so it was working till 4.2, because in 4.2, Tom Herbert did introduce some new feature in the flow that were breaking the hash function in the cluster flow mode of IF packet, which allow us to do load balancing on the software side. And so users did start to complain, and we've looked a lot to find a solution for that. To be honest, the best solution and the fastest solution was to talk with David, that did provide us a fix that I just managed to get it to stable. But it raised to us the interest of being able to do some load balancing in user space using, for example, AF packet cluster eBPF. One other point which is a bit not satisfactory for us at the time is the fact that the Intel NIC RSS hash is not currently symmetrical. For the XSIL, I don't remember the name of the driver, I think it's one is XGBE, you can't have a symmetric hash, so you can just not use RSSQ in that case. You don't have a good accuracy on that. And for the newest model, the 440G, in that case, the hardware is capable of doing that, but the driver doesn't provide the feature. So there is a patch from Victor Julien that you need to rework and to get it inside the driver. So as I mentioned before, one interest for us, for people that cannot upgrade their kernel to the stable release, is to use the eBPF cluster mode that will allow us to write our own load balancing function as an eBPF program and then inject it inside the kernel. So the cinematic is really simple. I've got there is a syscall to load the eBPF code in the kernel. Then I can just use setup options to specify that I want to use that eBPF filter inside. One of the problems that we have is that we got the problem of big flow. As you have seen, we've got a limited capacity in terms of bandwidth by one thread, and we want one thread to handle all the packets for a single flow. We cannot scale by splitting the flow, because if we split the flow, we will get back to the out-of-order packet, and then we lose our accuracy. So what we need to do is just currently to commit suicide. We've got a big flow because we can't handle anymore, and we start to drop packets. And then if you start to drop packets, we don't drop only the packet for the flow. So we just lose a lot of content in various flows. So we've got a really big issue with big flow. If we manage to bypass them, then in that case, we will really manage to get our accuracy far higher. I start to work on that for the previous net dev, and it has just been merged with some improvement. So now we've got a local bypass, which is done by Suricata, which is now able to say, okay, I just already seen too much of this flow, I just want to not to do anything to that. So it's just like a drop at Suricata side. And then we've got the capture bypass. In that case, we work with the lower layer to warn them that that we don't want to see any more packets from the flow. One thing to consider is that Suricata on the detection side is mainly there to allow you to make an analysis of attack and to detect attack. And really often, the attacks are done at the start of a TCP session. You don't really have often attack like the guy is transferring 10 megabytes, then after the 10 megabytes, you've got something which is an attack for the server. The server, usually, it's really a content transfer when you reach that kind of size, so you don't really want to know what is going on after this size. So we have a value which is stream reassembly def inside the Suricata config, and the stream is not anymore analyzed once we reach that limit. So if it's not anymore analyzed, then in that case, we can just decide to skip it once we reach that limit. We don't do any inspection, so why not just skip it? So that's what we can do now in the future version that will come in November by using stream bypass. You can just say, I don't want to see that anymore. And another interesting thing that we can do is that to do some selective bypass. In that case, we can have a signature that will say, for example, all the traffic to netdevconf, I trust it, so I just want to bypass any exchange that match the host name, the HTTP host name in that case, netdevconf. So on Suricata side, the basic method to do the bypass was really simple. We just introduce a callback that is defined by the capture method, and we call the callback, we don't want to see any more of a packet. So for NFQ, it was super simple. It was just setting a mark on the packet, and then the net filter rule set behind is just not sending to user space the packet with the mark, so it's really, really trivial. But it's just IPS, and if you want to switch to IDS in that case, using IF packet, it's a little bit more complicated, because what we would want to do is to be able to say, okay, I don't want the, what we want to do on, in a functional term is to say, I don't want to see any more packet for this flow. So this means that we need to have a flow table somewhere that will be known by the capture method, and the capture method will say, okay, packet is in the flow, then I don't send it to Suricata. So I tried with an F-table, but it's a with ingress queue, but it's a little bit too late because it's a F-packet is before. So what was next and what we're talking about since the beginning of the week is in that case is eBPF. So by using eBPF filter, I can have maps. In maps, I can have hash. If I can have hash, I can have a flow table. Then I can use that to get a flow table in user space and to populate a flow table from user space and then manage to do the bypass. So this one, I go quick. I got exactly what I want. As mentioned by Tom, the LLVM backend is really convenient to switch from C code to L5 that you can load into the kernel. So when I started to code, I've seen that we got to BCC, which is a nice framework to handle eBPF, so I started to play with BCC. So it handles everything. It takes the C code, dynamically build the BPF file, inject it into the kernel, do everything which is needed in terms of post-processing so you can easily work on your script, a script that you can write in Python, Lua, and even C++. My problem was that Suricata is developed in C, and the binding with C is not yet stable in BCC, so I was not able to use BCC to do that. So I decided to start the work on Suricata by implementing eBPF cluster, which was the simplest part. So as I mentioned before, it's just a syscall to that get the object in parameter, then the file descriptor is returned, and then you can just use set auction to define the filter. My initial version of the code was using the LLVM backend, so C file to ELF file. Then I wrote my own code to use libelf to load the file and inject it in the kernel. At the time of the code, what I found really, really useful was the fact that you can use BPF trace printk to debug your BPF filter, and then by using the tracing system, you manage to get the output of a BPF filter. So that was a really convenient method to save time when working on the BPF file. So it was a success by using this method. So I decided to do the exact same on the filter side. So I implemented the same thing. The BPF filter is loaded from the ELF file. Then I had to use something which was a little bit different. It was the map. But the map, are completely different, because what you need with a map is that you need to be able to create the map, because what you are doing is that you are loading the BPF file, then you need to find the map inside of the ELF file which is generated by LLVM. Once you've got this map, you have to get the parameter of the different map, then call the BPF create map function to instantiate the map inside the kernel and then map them to user space. And the worst part was the last one, is that once you've got this map which corresponds to an integer, you need to modify the L file to get a match inside the program that you will inject to the kernel. So for me, it was just game over. I cannot do that. It's far too complicated for me. So let's try to find somebody which is clever for me, which has already done that. That's the moment I decided to switch from to libbpf, which is inside tool libbpf of in the kernel tree, which provide high-level function to load ebpf L file, and that does everything I wanted: create maps for the user when we got maps in the L file, and do the relocation. The usage is quite simple. You just do bpf object program load. You open directly the L file, which bpf project open, then you get the BPF object that you can load into the you can load, then you can get the into the kernel. Sorry, then you can get the FD, the file descriptor that you will use to pass the option and to the self-stock option, and then get it used as a filter, and then you got some useful map function like loop on every map. So in that case, I'm looping on every map, get their file descriptor, get their map name, and then I can store the map inside Suricata to later usage. Sadly for me, libbpf is a work in progress. It's not network ready. For example, I was not able to say at the beginning, I want my the filter to be a network probe. It was not possible to do that. So I had to add a function to add the different filter type. Some functions were missing on the interaction. For example, it was not possible to update element from the map from the user space. So I'm currently working on that. I'm cleaning my code, and I will try to submit really, really soon. And the kernel code is the following in terms of eBPF filter. So the main part is this one. I got a lookup of an element in the float table V4, and then comes the really cool thing behind, is that I can still get accounting done by increasing the different value. For example, I got this function is called for every packet, so I can just increase the amount of packet by one. And then I can do the same on the SKB len, which will give me the number of bytes on this side. And the best part is this one for me, is that I can get the last timestamp of the flow by just getting the time at this moment. So this is what I am using in that part. It's the user space code. So I just do a loop to get on all the entry of the flow, and then I get the element, it's stored inside value, and I get the current time, and then I can make a comparison between the time from the user space and the last time we have seen a packet on the flow. So doing that, I know that the flow has not seen any packet from some times, and if it's the case, I get the different value for accounting, and then I delete the element because for inactivity. So this allows me to manage the flow table from user space without the need to have timer inside the kernel, because eBPF is triggered by on the packet path, so I can't have timer, and I don't want to iterate on the with some logic inside the kernel to make this cleaning. So NetDev 1.2 was not far away, so even I work on Beamer to have a turtle swim. But yeah, she don't want to dance. So sorry for that. So yes, Japan is was the host of Kame initiative that brought IPv6 to a lot of BSD, so I could not have, it was not possible not to have IPv6 support when coming here to speak. So yes, if IPv6 is the same as IPv4, it's easy. So let's do exactly the same. Let's just add a second hash table that we will use to contain the IPv6 tuple. and then we will be good. So yeah, okay. This one, in fact, this is my main message for the conference. Parsing eBPF is really cool, but you've done to redo the parsing of everything. So if somebody could come up with an initiative of common parsing function for IPv6, IPv4 that are really bulletproof and really easy to use, I sign. On the second part was IPv6 hashable. The second mapping was failing to load, so I was a bit lost. So I decided to call a friend. There is a good support of eBPF in TCBPF, and there is even documentation. But you should not trust people that write directly the man page in the man language, because when you look at what he says about IPv6, he says, let to the reader. So I was like, okay, this will not help me. For IPv6, in fact, the bug with the second hashtable was, the problem with the second hashtable was not a bug in the kernel or something like that. It was just a bug in eBPF. It was not using, in fact, it was not doing correctly the parsing of the ELF file and just using a simple algorithm that was not the good one compared to what should have been done. Read the commit message, it could be easier to find my explanation. Sorry about that. Finally, the call to a friend was correct because Daniel Borkman had done the good code in the tcbpf.c file, so I was able to fall back on my legs thanks to that. For the AIPv6 parsing problem, for now, I just decided that if people are using advanced IPv6 feature like extended header, then in that case, it may work to get the packet in the user space because it's advanced user, so we don't know what we are doing, so let's do not bypass people that use that kind of feature. So let's go for the result. So I've done my test on one of the bugs we have available, which is running on, which is sniffing some real traffic, so that's really nice to have real traffic to check that your code is working. The main problem with that is that it's not reproducible, so you cannot check that you get performance improvement by changing parameter on a really strict basis. So I decided to run a 1 hour long test run, changing the stream dev value, which means that we will be bypass a bit more if we decrease the value of a variable. And I collected I've added some counter to the Suricata statistics system. So I got a JSON event, and I inject the JSON event on Elasticsearch and use TimeLion to do the graphics. So it's not readable, so you got to trust me on that. Even me, I don't manage to read. So this is the number of bytes which are treated by Suricata, and blue is the bypass. So what we can see, and which is interesting, is that here we have a peak in the bypass. So it seems we got, at this moment on the flow, we got some intensive flow, and we managed to bypass completely without overloading Suricata. So this is with a standard stream dev value of 1 megabyte. And what we can see here is the percentage of instant percentage of bypass, when we see that we got a peak at 80%. So we really managed to lower the load on Suricata on this one. And on the drop side, this is the red line, it's quite peaceful, so the box is... next run was to use 512 kilobyte bypass, and I got an interesting thing which is just there, because we can see that the capture number in green, the capture packet, is almost null, because we had a really big flow at the time on the network, so we managed to completely bypass it. And then we can see here the percent of offloading is just climbing really, really, really high. So no cat pictures. Everybody's talking about cat, but nobody is showing them, so there it is. So Suricata and eBPF, Yes, it's really, really interesting. It's a bit fresh, but I think that we are not far with libBPF to have something which is really usable. I will do more tests on the performance side to work on the reproducible part. And if you want to hear more about the test, you can come to Suricon in Washington, the Suricata User Conference, beginning of November. The code is available, not yet finished for Suricata, not yet finished for libBPF, but I will really submit really, really soon, I think, end of the week, the libBPF code. I want to thank Alexei, Daniel, and David for their help on this project. So do we have questions?
So with regard to the symmetric hashing,
yeah.
I have to wonder if we're kind of on borrowed time with some of the properties that we're trying to extract out of this concept of a packet hash. So like the concept that hashes are persistent for whole connection, the concept that we can get the symmetric hash from both directions of the flow, the concept that we can reverse engineer a hash the hardware's given us. So those were definitely applicable, I think, in the straightforward world where we had TCP and it was a four tuple, easily reverse the source and destination to get the same hash. But as we see, when we get encapsulation, when we start doing things with like IPv6 flow label, the world of hashing becomes more complicated. And in fact, one of the things that we're purposely doing in some cases is actually changing the hash that would be calculated by changing the properties on the wire. And this is part of, I think I had on the slide before, flow bender, which is we're detecting a failing TCP connection. Can we force the network to take a different path? So in the old days with ECMP on TCP, you can't do that. But in this new world where we either have encapsulation or we have flow labels, we can actually do that. But what that means in effect is that that hash is no longer persistent for the connection. And it's actually getting more interesting because for security reasons, we want to stop people from, you know, track packets in the network, which means we have to keep modifying the hash because the hash is based on things they could track. The net result of this is that actually the properties that are guaranteed to be in a hash are I think, a smaller subset than what we're using sometimes, and we might need to revisit that. But this also is going to wreak havoc at some point on load balancers. Trying to do a load balancer based on a static hash, I think that's heavily on borrowed time, so that's one of the things that needs to be adopted or needs to be adapted to this new world.
Yeah, in fact, on the hash part, you just have different constraints from what we have. On our side, we just want to have everything on a single thread. Even if it's not really correct in terms of balancing, and if you, for example, if you change the flow label, If people start to change the flow label a lot, what we can just do on our side is to get back to eBPF cluster, and that we just, for example, extract the outer tuple and use that. If it's not a asymmetric routing or asymmetric transport, it will be okay for us.
That presumes you can get into an inner tuple, though. So there's going to be cases where all you have is the outer tuple, the inner tuple is encrypted.
So yeah, until
you get to the application, that's the only guy who could actually know what the inner tuple is. So my point is that the hash is at some level is not going to be complete and persistent information.
Yeah, sure.
And we just need to adapt to that.
For example, I shortened my talk because it was shortened at NetDev. But the thing I've implemented as a first step in load balancing was just IP pair. So a really simple source IP and second source IP that you make an addition. It's just enough for us. And it's even one of the best case possible to just have this kind of stupid load balancing. For us, it's enough.
So Tom, actually, I have a question for you, it seems, in reverse, over here. So, I mean, you have to keep up to the layer 4 hash consistent, otherwise you break the rest of the fabric underneath, right? You're not really saying...
What do we break?
So the concept of resilient hashing, for example, would be required, otherwise your ECMP paths might go the wrong way.
So ECMP require the concept of ECMP is to route packets of the same flow consistently, right?
Correct.
But that can be done in microflows. That doesn't say the packets have to be routed the exact same way for the next year. To get the value of ECMP, we need that to be a temporal thing, maybe over a second. But if I have a bad route, why don't I just change the hash to take advantage of ECMP in a sense? ECMP would give me a different route. That's actually what FlowBender does.
Sure, but I mean, if everything is built to take advantage of those microflows and will adapt to that, then yes. But if you have an application that is expecting connections to stay in the direction in which it had been steered first, and for the lifetime of that application, it doesn't expect that to change.
That's my point. Applications should not do that. The only case that we have would be a stateful firewall or a NAT. But in that case, we can't break things. Now NAT becomes interesting with something like QUIC, where we have a QUIC connection going, and then the NAT translations drop, and then we get a new NAT translation. The expectation of QUIC is that connection will continue, which means there's no persistence between the outer IP headers and UDP port numbers and the UDP connection. That's actually the direction that we're going to go. So we're decoupling the outer information from what the connection actually is. I call it disassociated location.
No, that part I get, but I'm actually only talking about the outer, and maybe we have completely gone off topic here, so maybe this is an offline conversation, but my high-level point would be, if you cannot rely on the outer hash to be consistent, many other things would break.
So let's talk offline. I wouldn't know exactly what breaks.
Okay.
Speaking of QUIC and the problems you're having with hardware hash functions and the XDP work that's been talked about a lot, have you considered basically ignoring RSS and just implementing your own software-based RSS in one core, dedicating that?
Yeah, that is what we're currently doing, in fact, because there is no official driver that allows us to have a symmetric hash. So what we're currently recommending is to disable RSS and then to use cluster flow.
So you use, when you say cluster flow, are you talking about packet fanout?
Yeah, packet fanout, yeah.
So XDP is much earlier, right?
Yeah, sure. So in that case, what we can use is the code I've done on the eBPF cluster and inject the same, what we could do because it's standard, but it's to inject the same code that is doing getting the tuple or getting some information and then reading a hash from that.
Okay, so to talk about QUIC, that has a connection ID, so if you have a slightly smarter RSS, you would use something like that?
So one thing we're thinking about doing is having an XDP return code, which is XDP dump, and this could be siloed into a fanout-based mechanism, so you could use XDP directly to do packet fanout. And it would all be handled in this one blob. It wouldn't even make it into the stack. And he could use that kind of facility to do this.
So ironically, and I will mention this again, we need an RSS that uses BPF.
Yeah, exactly. One more question. So you're using fanout with BPF to select a thread. Do you then use a separate BPF program to do the filtering to drop those big flows?
Currently use two different filters, yeah.
Because a trick you can do is basically have a bunch of sockets that you never read from that you just treat as dev null, and then you send your big flows there eventually, and you don't only run one BPF program.
Yeah, could work, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, with XDP is even better, but the idea of combining the two programs into one, as opposed to the separate ones he has now.
we're running out of time, so let's move on to the good part.